Hello, I'm Massimo Federico from University of Modena and Reggio Emilia in Italy, and I'd like to present a case of Hodgkin lymphoma that I consider a challenging case, and probably thanks to drugs we were able also to offer an additional opportunity of cure. This is the story of a patient of 57-year-old that presented drenching night sweat and also noted the swelling of a lymph node in the inguinal region, and this finding was also confirmed at the physical examination, where we found the presence of 2.5 centimeter lymph node. To achieve the diagnosis, an ischisional biopsy was performed of the right inguinal node, and the diagnosis was suggestive of Hodgkin lymphoma due to the presence of large cell containing two nuclear lobes, and also some lacunar cells were present. Based also on the immunohistochemical phenotype, it was characterized by CD30 positive disease, PAX5 positive, WAKE, CD15 and CD20, the final diagnosis of classical Hodgkin lymphoma, nodular sclerosis type, was performed. CT scan revealed some enlarged lymph nodes on both sides of diaphragm. Majority of them were below the diaphragms. The large lymph node was a 40 millimeters common iliac lymph node. The same findings were confirmed by the PET CT, and once again several lymph nodes, mostly all of them below the diaphragms, were found, and also an aspecific marrow activation was reported. Patients were then defined with stage 3B disease, no bulky disease, and patients was offered to be enrolled in the RATUL trial. At the time in our institution, this was the investigational approach for those patients with extended disease, and the patients accepted to be enrolled into the trial, and he received two courses of ABVD as the classical regimen, and delivered at full doses perfectly on time. This is the outline of the RATUL trial. It was a PET-oriented trial, a large phase 3 international trial led by the UK research team. The study was designed to see if it was possible to modify treatment intensity according to the results of interim PET. Patients with PET negative after two courses were randomized to receive or standard additional four courses of ABVD or four courses of the same regimen without bleomycin. Patients that at interim PET resulted PET positive received or four courses of BCOP-14 or three courses of BCOP escalated, and according to the final PET were or consolidated with one or two more courses of BCOP, or addressed to salvage therapy if they were still PET positive. Our patients, after two courses of ABVD, had persistence of FDG uptake, was classified as a partial response with Deauville score 4, and then, according to the protocol, was shifted to escalated BCOP. Deauville score 4 was defined according to the Sallie-Barrington recommendations. That means a residual uptake higher than the liver uptake. Received four courses of BCOP escalated following the first two courses with ABVD and achieved a complete remission. Unfortunately, an early relapse on previous reported sites occurred 5 months after the end of treatment. So the problem was which kind of salvage therapy to offer to our patients. For those who fit for autologous stem cell, high dose therapy and autologous stem cell transplant, this in our institution is considered the standard therapy to be considered, based mostly on the results of Norbert Schmidt trial that compared the BEAM plus high dose therapy against DexaBeam, superior progression free survival. So patients was addressed to an high dose treatment. We in Italy use IGEV instead of DAP or ICE. IGEV is a combination of ifosfamide, gemcitabine, and vinorelbine. Unfortunately, after one course, we had to discontinue this treatment due to the occurrence of severe neurotoxicity. Insipidus diabetes was diagnosed probably due to the use of ifosfamide. Then we shifted patients to the DAP regimen, and after one course of DAP, patients was also admitted into the hospital for severe sepsis and also pseudomembranous colitis. Restaging at this time showed that the disease was still present, so the two courses of salvage therapy, IGEV first and DAP later on, did not control the disease, and then we decided to switch to a different salvage therapy with bendamustine. Patients received a total of 4 courses of bendamustine at the dose of 90 milligrams square meters, day 1 and 2 every 28 days. Unfortunately, disease evaluation after 4 courses of Benda showed a disease progression due to the onset of new lesions in the left inguinal nodes and in the both axillary regions. And according to our standard guidelines, being not respondent to conventional chemotherapy, we considered the patients again not eligible to move to high dose therapy. So for these patients at that moment, we were in the situation of no standard treatment we could offer to him, because we already adopted 2 different conventional chemotherapy regimen, 2 different salvage types of chemotherapy, and patients were still with active disease. Fortunately, at that time, several novel therapies could be considered, although all of them investigational. We focused our attention on the anti-CD30, brentuximab vedotin. Why we focused on the anti-CD30? Because CD30 was expressed in the majority of Reed-Sternberg cells, in this case of Hodgkin lymphoma patient, and also because the CD30 is highly restricted in normal tissue, so the risk of side effects is quite limited. In a pivotal study that showed first the efficacy of brentuximab vedotin in a group of 102 patients relapsed after high dose therapy plus autologous stem cell transplant, a very promising overall response rate of 75% was achieved with 34% of complete remission. And in this setting, as a single agent, brentuximab vedotin resulted in one of the most effective therapy for this kind of patient. What was also well documented that the progression-free survival with brentuximab was highly superior to the most recent prior systemic therapy in the same patient, confirming the efficacy of the drug and also the absence of cross-resistance with previous treatment. Based on these results, brentuximab was licensed from FDA and EMA for treating patients relapsing after high dose therapy plus autologous stem cell transplant, or patients considered unfit for high dose therapy but still with active disease after 2 full courses of conventional chemotherapy. our patient was considered ineligible for high-dose therapy, received more than two courses of conventional chemotherapy, and then we could also offer this to these patients brentuximab vedotin according to the named patient program at the time available in our country. Patients achieved a complete remission after the first two courses of brentuximab vedotin, and then we decided to offer these patients a consolidation with high-dose therapy plus autologous stem cell transplant. Just to organize the high-dose therapy programs, patients received three more courses of brentuximab, so we received a total of five courses, and the procedure was completed successfully. And patients maintained complete remission, and also at last visit a few months ago, patients was in complete remission lasting more than 3 years. And this is the PET scan after the first two courses of brentuximab vedotin. No uptake was observed. The results achieved in these patients compare favorable with those recently reported in the extended follow-up manuscript of patients treated in the pivotal study. In that update, 18 patients following treatment with brentuximab vedotin still maintain a complete remission, although six of them were consolidated with allogeneic stem cell transplant. But 12 of them had a persistent complete remission lasting in some cases more than 3 years. So in conclusion, these are the main take-home message from the story of these patients. That first of all, treatment of patients with Hodgkin lymphoma failing at least two prior therapies is a challenging situation. In chemo-resistant disease, the use of high-dose therapy followed by autologous stem cell transplant is not an option, at least in our institution and in the majority of the guidelines in the field available for Hodgkin lymphoma. As mentioned, brentuximab vedotin is a promising approach for these patients. And what I believe that is most important, in patients responding to brentuximab vedotin before high-dose therapy, the consolidation with autologous stem cell transplant should be considered. And in this setting, brentuximab could act as a bridge to cure, like in our patients. Thank you for your attention, and I hope that this case history could help in your clinical practice.